Shalom, Hebrews and Shebrews. This is Oilfield Disciple, and we are going to be doing our daily reading, 1 Samuel chapter 5 and Acts chapter 2. We'll give a short commentary here. I'm going to try to keep these videos under 20 minutes, and I'm doing my best to get more diligent in doing these daily videos. Got a lot going on, and since I've been off for a length of time not doing daily videos, it's kind of just been not a struggle, but it hasn't been natural as I was whenever I was doing them every day. So just bear with me, and we will get back on the old horse and get her going here. We're gonna start off in Acts chapter 2. Set that video there. Acts chapter 2, we're going to see the Holy Spirit poured out upon us. And whenever it talks about in Joel that he will pour out his Spirit on all flesh, I hear it constantly today that this being the end of times, surely he's going to pour out his Spirit. Well, he's already done it. He done it right here in Acts, 50 days after Messiah, our Lord Jesus, Yeshua, ascended to the right hand of the Father. And it's been a continual ongoing process of his Spirit poured out upon us. Now, this is not the first time for what modern churchianity calls it Pentecost. It's the festival of Shavuot. It's one of the seven Moedim, or seven appointed times of Yahweh. But this is not the first time. If you look back in Exodus, at the Mount, when God spoke his commands to Israel, and they all became frightened and scared, and they told Moses, man, you go deal with God, and you come back, tell us what he said. You just be our mediator, our go-between. That was actually the first time. And so let's look at this, and let's look at as I read this, speaking in tongues is not necessarily this gibberish that we hear today's false teachers and false anointed ones speaking today of that. You know, you just hear them rattling on and on and on, saying that they're speaking God's language. This is me speaking like this right here in English, but you've been able to hear it in Chinese or Russian or French or whatever your native tongue is that you understand. Also goes back to the Tower of Babel, when God looked at the unity of mankind and said, there's nothing that man can't do if he stays joined and united. Let me divide their language so they do not understand one another. Here he's giving us a glimpse back into what that looked like prior to that language barrier that we all suffer from today. Acts 2 verse 1 says, and when the day of the festival of Shavuot had come, they were all with one mind in one place. Shavuot was Pentecost. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and settled on each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them to speak. This is separate from speaking in tongues. This is a separate deal. You're filled with the fire of the Holy Ghost. I believe that there is a language that one can speak when the Holy Spirit totally engulfs and fulfills your flesh, your body. You will speak in a foreign language to yourself. It's a godlike language, but I don't believe, like we see in today's false churchianity, at one's whim being able to just rattle something off. It may sound like that, it may not to you. I believe this is a personal interaction with the Holy Spirit that each one of us may or may not have through our flesh, our physical lives here. It's separate than speaking in tongues, of being able to, me be able to speak a message, and anyone of any language can understand that language, can understand that message without me having to have an interpreter or using an interpreter. Does that make sense? Separate. All right. Verse 5. Now in Jerusalem, there were dwelling the Yehudim, dedicated men from every nation under the heaven. And when this sound came to be, the crowd came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, "Look, are not all these who speak the Galileans?" Now the Galileans, they were kind of your common, you know, lower class people. They didn't have much sophistication. There wasn't much education amongst them. And so it's kind of a demeanor, talking down to these guys. It's like, how they speak, and how do I understand them in Russian whenever they ain't never been to school to learn but one language? Something like this, similar to that. All right, so the Galileans, you know, I mean, we even hear when Jesus is still walking amongst us, "Has anything good ever come out of Galilee?" One man proclaims. And so here we are. Verse 8. "And how do we hear, each one in our own language in which we were born? The Parthians and Medes and the Elamites and those dwelling in Aram, Naharaim, both Yehuda and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, both Phrygia, Pamphylus, Mitzrayim, and the parts of Libya around Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Yehudim and the converts, the Cretans and the Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the great deeds of Elohim." And they were all amazed and were puzzled, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" And others mocked, said, "They have been filled with sweet wine. They're drunk. Look at these drunkards. They're just babbling on." Well, if they're drunk, how come they're able to, you're able to understand them in your native tongue? Goes back to whenever truth hits us, rebellion sets in. Those who are not diligently seeking the Lord. And I don't care what kind of evidence you lay down for the truth, if someone is hard-hearted towards it, it don't matter. If you show them evidence after evidence, they're not going to get it. But Peter, Kepha, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said to them, "Men of Yehuda, and all those dwelling in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen closely to my words. For these men are not drunk, as you imagine, since it's only the third hour of the day." The third hour is not 3 o'clock in the afternoon, but 8 o'clock in the morning is the third hour. And so he's proclaiming, they're not drunk, it ain't 8 o'clock yet. I mean, they ain't had time to get drunk. "But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall be in the last days, says Elohim, that I shall pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And also on my male servants and my female servants, I shall pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. And I shall show wonders in the heaven above and the signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and splendid day of Yahweh. And it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of Yahweh shall be saved." All right, this is present tense. Joel was speaking of it in future tense, but it's present tense. Not only for these men and Yehuda and Judah here as the new the renewed covenant begins, I'm trying to figure out how the easiest way is. This is an ongoing thing since this time till now. Yahweh's poured out his spirit, his Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit, upon us, that all who call upon the name of the Lord. Now, we don't have to go to a priest. We don't have to go to a Levite to have our prayers heard by Yahweh. We can go through Messiah via Holy Spirit directly to the Father in prayer. Another one, whenever it says that your daughter shall prophesy and your young men see vision. Prophesying simply just means speaking in lieu of the Lord, speaking the message of the Lord. It doesn't have to be a prophetic future event to come. To prophesy just simply means to relay the word of God. Verse 22, and the men of Israel hear these words. Yeshua of Nazareth, a man from Elohim, having been pointed out to you by mighty works and wonders and signs which Elohim did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know, this one, given up by the set purpose and foreknowledge of Elohim, you have impaled and put to death through the hands of lawless men. Him Elohim raised up, and having loosed the pangs of death, because it was impossible that he could be held in its grip. For Dawid says concerning him, I saw Yahweh before me continually, because he is at my right hand, in order that I should not be shaken. For this reason my heart rejoiced, and my tongue was glad, and now my flesh shall also rest in expectation. Because you shall not leave my being in Sheol, nor shall you give your loving committed one to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You shall fill me with joy in your presence. That is Psalm 16, 8 through 11. Verse 29. Men and brothers, let me speak boldly to you of the ancestor David, that he died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day, being a prophet. Then, and knowing that Elohim had sworn with an oath to him of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, to raise up the Messiah to sit on his throne. Foreseeing this, he spoke concerning the resurrection of Messiah, that his being was neither left in Sheol, nor did his flesh see corruption. Elohim has raised up this Yeshua, of which we are all witness. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of Elohim, and having received from the Father of the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you know, which you now see and hear. For Dawid did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself said, Yahweh said to my master, set at my right hand, and I will make your enemies a footstool for your feet. That's Psalms 110, verse 1. Therefore let all the house of Israel know for certain that Elohim has made this Yeshua, whom you impaled, both master and Messiah. And having heard this, they were pierced to the heart, and they said to Peter and the rest of the emissaries, apostles, men, brothers, what shall we do? And Kepha, or Peter, said to them, repent, and let each one of you be immersed in the name of Yeshua Messiah for the forgiveness of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children, and to all who are afar off, as many as Yahweh or Elohim shall call. Ephesians 2 and 8, we're saved by grace through faith. Lest we boast, it's not of ourselves. Yahweh calls us. And with many other words he earnestly witnessed and urged him, saying, be saved from this crooked generation. Then those indeed who gladly received his word were immersed or baptized. And on that day 3,000 beings were added to them. And they were continuing steadfastly in the teaching of the apostles, and in the fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. today's evangelism is such a mockery of this. That come down to the altar and say this little prayer. Lord, come into my life and come into my heart, blah, blah, blah. And then they go and proclaim on TV that 5,000 people were saved today, or 500 people, or 50 people were saved today. That's a false proclamation. It deters me to hear and see that today. We don't ask Yeshua into our hearts. I've said this over and over again. We don't ask Yeshua into our hearts until he comes and he calls us. Then we have that feeling. Then we have that repentance. But it has to be a true repentance. Not this, I heard this feel-good message and I'm going to run up to the altar and have this pastor pray over me and pray with me. And, you know, and we're going to ask the Lord into my heart now. Jesus coming into your life whether you ask for him or not, if you've been called. So be weary of those who make these false claims and false proclamations about how many was saved in their ministry. Verse 43, and fear came upon every being, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all those who believed were together and had all in common, and sold their possessions and property, and divided them among all, as anyone might have need. And day by day, continuing with one mind in the holy place, and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising Elohim and having favor with all people. And the Master added to the assembly those who were being saved day by day. We're not going to get to 1 Samuel today. We're already 17 minutes in. I'm keeping these videos under 20 minutes. So let's deal with what we're dealing with right here. Let's look at this and let's make sure we have a full understanding of this. When Yeshua calls us, when God calls us and he comes into our lives and we begin to repent and we begin to walk in his ways, our acts will follow us. Good deeds will follow us. The fruit of the Spirit will follow us because God has called us, because Yeshua has begun to straighten our lives out where we were once crooked. And it is by no choice of our own. I guess it's the $50 million question, that if he calls you, do we have the ability to reject him? I say no, to the point of, I look at Paul. Paul was on the road, Damascus, to go and kill those who were proclaiming Jesus as their Lord. And he believed he was doing it for God. And when Jesus came and presented himself to Saul, who we know as Paul, that glory is so intense that rejecting him at that point, I don't see it, you know. So it goes back to, if we reject Messiah, if we reject Jesus, were we ever truly called? Did we ever have salvation to begin with? And I have to say no, because there's too much evidence throughout Scripture that backs up the validation that we're called by God. We're not going to get out of that. When Jesus says, all those you have given me, Father, into my hand, I will not let go. Well, if he's got you, he's not letting go. You're not hanging on to him. He's hanging on to you. He's not letting go. Where are you going? You feel me? So it goes back to that circular way of thinking rather than linear. We're saved by grace through faith. It takes faith to walk in God, but it takes his grace for us to even begin to have faith. But faith is what pleases God. And so it's not a linear time frame, but rather circular, cyclical or circular. And that's something we have a hard time grasping in this culture and concepts today. We're linear thinkers. You know, I was born in 76 and today's 2020, so I'm 44. Versus Yahweh had me in mind before the foundations of the earth. And when I die, I'm going to go be with the Father. But when I die, I'm going to lay in the grave until that time of judgment. For me, it's going to be instantaneous. But for those who are still bound by time, as far as they're concerned, I'm in the grave. If that makes sense. But I'll make another video here in a little bit on 1 Samuel chapter 5. We're going to look at Dagon in the temple and the ark and all that. Another good teaching. And so Acts chapter 2 will be this video. And then later in a little bit, I'll get 1 Samuel chapter 5 done. Y'all be blessed, be encouraged, and always be frustrated. This is Oilfield Disciple. Y'all go check this stuff out for yourself.